sun rising on a new day in Havana is finally more than just a pretty picture or an empty phrase. The surprise move to begin restoring diplomatic relations between the U.S. and Cuba hit like a shockwave, and people will debate what's right and what's next. But this program is not about the politics. It's about a country we don't know and the people we're not allowed to know. We hope to help change that by giving you a view inside Havana few Americans ever get. We have no government minders or monitors looking over our shoulder as we move freely in Havana and talk freely with the people in Cuba Unlocked. Forget all the mystery and controversy about Americans traveling to Havana. My first big shock after stepping off that chartered jet from Miami is how welcoming Havana seems. No Cuban army guards with guns at the gate, just a plain little building. No monument to Fidel Castro anywhere either. This could almost be a small rural airport in America until you step outside. This is all new to us. Lots of very anxious, very happy Cubans everywhere, their eyes searching for arriving family members, sometimes greeting relatives they've never met before. Family after family is out waiting with signs, cheering when people arrive from mostly the United States to come to Cuba or come back to Cuba to see the people they love. It's just everywhere you see, it's almost like it's a party here. And as I said before, I've never seen anything quite like it. And right on cue, Cuba's classic car show begins. As people roll up to the curb to pick up the cousins in their shiniest vintage gas-guzzling American sedans from the 1950s. Just like you'd expect. Think it's a cliche? Think it's impossible for that many 60-year-old heaps to look like they are headed out to the sock hop? The sun rising on a new day in Havana is finally more than just a pretty picture or an empty phrase. The surprise move to begin restoring diplomatic relations between the U.S. and Cuba hit like a shockwave, and people will debate what's right and what's next. But this program is not about the politics. It's about a country we don't know and the people we're not allowed to know. We hope to help change that by giving you a view inside Havana few Americans ever get. We have no government minders or monitors looking over our shoulder as we move freely in Havana and talk freely with the people in Cuba Unlocked. Forget all the mystery and controversy about Americans traveling to Havana. My first big shock after stepping off that chartered jet from Miami is how welcoming Havana seems. No Cuban army guards with guns at the gate, just a plain little building. No monument to Fidel Castro anywhere either. This could almost be a small rural airport in America until you step outside. This is all new to us. Lots of very anxious, very happy Cubans everywhere, their eyes searching for arriving family members, sometimes greeting relatives they've never met before. Family after family is out waiting with signs, cheering when people arrive from mostly the United States to come to Cuba or come back to Cuba to see the people they love. It's just everywhere you see, it's almost like it's a party here. And as I said before, I've never seen anything quite like it. And right on cue, Cuba's classic car show begins. As people roll up to the curb to pick up the cousins in their shiniest vintage gas-guzzling American sedans from the 1950s. Just like you'd expect. Think it's a cliche? Think it's impossible for that many 60-year-old heaps to look like they are headed out to the sock hop to still be out there? Wait till you're out on the road heading into the city. They are everywhere. But as I'll explain a little later, all this old sculpted sheet metal belching God knows what out of the exhaust pipe may not be all that it appears. Havana is made up of 15 different municipalities, and it turns out, in the nicer ones, people with video cameras aren't particularly welcome. Actually, almost no one walks those streets much, but driving into the heart of Havana, it doesn't look much different than any other island nation in the Western Hemisphere, at first. Sure, the modes of transportation cover a very wide range, but it's what's missing and what stands in its place that jumps out at you. No ads on the billboards. None. I guess with no real free enterprise and no big business or industry that's not controlled by the communist government, there's no need. Mile after mile, any large sign or even mural painted on a wall either honors the revolution of 1959, immortalizes Fidel Castro, Che Guevara, Jose Marti, and other Cuban heroes, or, for a change of pace, some signs brag about some government program. In fact, Cubans still hear and see a lot about how wonderful the revolution was, and how great they have it now. And you might almost believe it. Mid-morning in the inner city of Havana, that rooftop rooster still has something to say after crowing since 5 a.m. The streets wake up slowly here. No one seems to be running for the bus, trying to catch a cab, make it to a meeting, or anything else that might require rushing. And the rooster isn't the only one with a song. This is morning rush hour down the street in the neighborhood. And there are plenty of almost crashes, but no yelling at that stupid driver who cuts you off. Not even any cursing, that you can hear anyway. Manhattan or Miami, this certainly is not. But Romeo Medina can't even get out there on the streets yet to make a few dollars. He drives, okay, he pedals, really, what they call a bicitaxi in Cuba. His pockets stay empty. There's a flat tire or bad wheel. Yeah. Luckily, the repair shop, about the size of a closet cut into the outside wall, one of those dilapidated stone buildings on the block, is open 24 hours.
When's the peak time for taxi service? When do you ride the most?
Right now.
When it's raining. Yeah. Makes sense. How long have you been driving a taxi? You drive it?
Hace cuánto tiempo estás manejando este taxi?
Aproximadamente 15 años.
Approximately 15 years.
10 years. And what do you charge to ride the taxi?
¿Qué cobras tú por los viajes?
Eso depende de la distancia de las carreras.
Depends the distance.
Is it a living?
¿Lo hace para vivir?
Para motivar la vida. Para motivar la vida.
To get by.
To get by. What else? How long do you do this every day?
¿Qué tiempo te pasas en el bicitaxi al día?
Aproximadamente.
Approximately.
5 or 6 hours.
5 or 6 hours a day.
You must have strong legs.
Tienes piernas muy fuertes, entonces.
Sí.
But his strength goes a lot deeper than the physical. This 55-year-old man once lived a very different life. Romeo's street friends, who seem to have nowhere to go themselves while he struggles to fix the wheel, call him the professor. He was once a teacher, but that was a long time ago. And now the very possibility that Americans may be coming to Havana to do business or just to see the city gives him some hope.
It's time for a change.
Okay, yo no estoy con la revolución, bueno, y
I was born in the middle of the revolution, and I never thought that this would happen, so I'm guessing that there is going to be change.
What's the number one thing you'd like to see happen in your lifetime now?
¿Qué es la primera cosa que quisieras ver que cambia en tu vida?
En mi vida. Que haya posibilidad económica para todo el mundo.
That I just have a possibility to make money. That's the only thing I want. With possibilities, I don't have to ride the taxi all day. I used to be a teacher and I used to work for an art school. But since they claimed that I was an anti-communist, they took me out of the school and I no longer work for the education. It was in 1992.
That's tough. It doesn't seem fair to me at all.
That's exactly what it is. Not fair.
Maybe change is coming.
A lo mejor cambio viene.
Hace falta, le dije. Hace falta. Hace falta.
We need it. We need it desperately. We all need it. A long time ago, we needed it.
But there are a lot more immediate needs of the Cuban people under a government that's supposed to be built to take care of all. I can't help but notice the street dogs everywhere. They're all over Havana, scrounging for food, trying to avoid getting stepped on or run over.
Hola.
And there's a parallel in some of the lives you can walk into.
Pardon me. Excuse me.
Around every corner. It is 10:26 in the morning. At the fruit stand, the prices are as high as the most expensive supermarket you'll see in a major American city. A lime for $3, tomatoes at $7 a pound, and no long lines at checkout.
Where is everybody?
¿Dónde está todo el mundo? Comprando. No money.
Money. Just a few dollars a day is why Tomas Leva stands by himself along this busy street, holding a small plastic bag from the farmacia or maybe from the grocery store. He is 70 years old and retired and doesn't really want us to take pictures of what he's doing.
How are you? What are you doing today?
¿Cómo estás? ¿Qué haces hoy?
¿Qué hago? Vendo popro, vendo cosas por la calle.
But because he doesn't have a license to sell, Tomas admits he could get in trouble. He buys from the state store or from somebody with access to a state store, then he sells the goods here. Apparently, there's a black market in Havana for almost everything. He works 8 hours a day, standing on the street, alone.
He buys it from the state and then he sells it on the street. Millions of people do it.
How much money can you take in?
¿Cuánto dinero hace el mamá?
¿Cuánto dinero me gano? Bueno, gano el doble.
He makes double of whatever he buys. Possibly. Buys it for one, sells it for two.
How many hours a day do you sell?
¿Cuántas horas al día te dedicas a vender?
4 por la mañana y 4 por la tarde.
4 hours in the morning, 4 hours during the noon.
Entonces, pues, el retiro no me alcanza. Porque las cosas son muy caras hoy en día.
I'm retired, but it's not enough because everything is too expensive nowadays.
So prices have gone up?
So los precios han subido. De las cosas. Yes, yes. Yeah, dramatically. ¿Desde cuándo?
Aumentado. Desde el año 90 para acá.
Since the 1990 and on.
That's when the Soviet Union was gone.
Yep. Desde que se fue la Unión Soviética.
Efectivamente.
In fact, the Soviet Union's communist government once poured literally billions of dollars into the Cuban economy every year until the Marxist system crumbled. Now all Havana gets is visits from a Russian spy ship, which was docked here while the U.S. Assistant Secretary of State became the highest level American diplomat to talk with the Cuban government here in a long, long time.
We discussed in real and concrete terms the required steps for the reestablishment of diplomatic relations between our countries.
No doubt they listened to every word that was said, and probably every word that I said during several days of live satellite reports from a Havana rooftop.
How soon will real change come? Good evening. I'm Todd McDermott, live from Havana, Cuba. What do you think of closer ties with the U.S. in the future?
¿Qué crees tú de Estados Unidos y Cuba atarse en el futuro?
Bueno, Cuba y Estados Unidos están relacionadas hace años, ¿verdad? Desde la colonia, desde que se vino con ahí, muy bien. Y han tenido bastante relaciones, que deben hacer relaciones y deben seguir amistad y, bueno, y ayudándose, ¿verdad? Tener amistad, relacionarnos. Tratar de, como bueno, con el mundo entero.
As our conversation concluded, Tomás made sure to tell me that it's not that bad in Cuba. Wagging his finger, he said with pride that compared to other nations, Cubans are doing well, but they are not the worst country in the world. He ended, there's nobody on the streets without a home. But just a few minutes later, a few blocks down the street, we found out that just isn't true. There are stories behind some of these doors that are very hard to see, like this man's. Doctors can't help him. The Cuban healthcare system here turns out young physicians so well trained that the government can trade their services for cheap oil from Venezuela. But neighbors found him in the street, sick, with nowhere to go. They tell me his house fell down, crumbled to bits long ago.
He has deterioration in his bones. So they can't IV him or anything.
Tanya Sandoval, who took him in, says the doctors will not, cannot treat his bone disease.
So what happens to him now?
He can't walk, so we're unsure what will happen to him.
Will any hospital take him? Doctor?
Ningún doctor, nada lo lleva, no nada.
No, se llevó al carrito vacío, lo atendieron un momentico y por la misma lo sacaron.
We went real quickly, but they didn't give him much and they sent him home.
Tanya says she'll take care of him as long as he has nobody else to help. Overhearing our conversation, the man said in Spanish, "Don't worry about me. I'm going to die." The fact that Tanya Sandoval has reached out and taken him in says so much about the Cuban people. She has so very little herself. She's very excited to show us her home. Today is Tanya's 70th birthday.
So this is where you live, back here?
This is where I live. I'm fixing it up, but it takes time.
You sleep here?
Y duermo usted aquí. Sí.
Doesn't look that comfortable.
It's not.
Does this protect you from the rain?
So esto no te protege del agua, el techo.
No, pero cae gotera y el sol está, si no se arregla, el sol es completo.
Water comes in often and I have to keep fixing it.
How long have you lived here?
¿Hace cuánto vives aquí?
37 years.
37 years. And then what's in here?
That's right, almost 40 years inside these bare concrete walls. There's a second room here in the back, but the camera really can't convey the feeling here of being in a dank, dark cave. Buckets and plastic bottles are everywhere. Electricity comes in a web of wiring that screams fire hazard. There's a pipe, maybe that's what brings the water in from the well, but it's hard to tell. I didn't see a sink. And you don't drink that water straight from the source.
We throw in a disinfectant.
You put a disinfectant in the well water?
Adentro del agua le echas el disinfectante.
Then it's okay to drink?
Y después la puedes tomar. Yes.
Not easy.
No es fácil, no?
Hard life.
Vida dura.
Pero se va a arreglar.
But it'll be fixed.
Pictures of her mother and sister are in a place of honor. And she still has this hope. Before we left, she told me our visit to her home is the best gift she's ever received. And it feels humbling.
It's your birthday today? Happy birthday.
Felicidad.
Felicidad.
The more we walk the neighborhood, the more people want to reach out to us.
Hello, guys.
But it's not necessarily the young ones. The older people know exactly who we are, what we are, and why we are here, as if an American TV crew is some kind of advance party for the wave of U.S. dollars and visitors speeding toward Playa del Este Beach, north of town. It seems all the older folks on the street have a story, and they're not afraid to share it. even if it can sometimes get a little disjointed.
Where are you from?
Hola, Estados Unidos.
Oh, very cool. Nueva York. California.
Florida.
Oh, lo máximo. Hace falta ahí que me den una foto. Yo, boxeador.
Boxer. Yes. As this man gave me a little routine about his days as a boxer, or was it a kickboxer, it didn't feel much different than a conversation you'd hear on the corner of a busy American street. Except they all want to bring it back to the same subject, Estados Unidos y Cuba. But back for a second to the more wary younger generation.
Hola.
Part of their more careful approach to all the guys with the cameras and microphones is that we figured out they might be afraid we could be Cuban state television. After all, no one who has a job or wants a job or wants an education wants trouble. It's as if some of them are afraid to stand out or be put on the spot or draw any attention at all from anybody with the Cuban government. But then there was Rio, who's lived in Havana all of her 76 years. Once she saw the chance to talk, she took it.
That you guys are visiting, and I'm very happy you guys are visiting. We have very good relationships with the United States. You are a country just like ours. Warriors. Admirable. Everything has to be normal.
Paz, amor.
Peace. Love. Very important. A lot of peace and a lot of love.
Would you like to see more Americans come here?
¿Quiere ver más americanos venir aquí a Cuba a visitar?
Sí, como no.
Yes, of course.
Como no.
More visitors.
¿Por qué no? Si ustedes son humanos como nosotros.
Why not? If you guys are human just like us.
Nuevas, tenemos que
especially
tener
now with these new relationships, of course.
This is exciting.
¿Te excita los cambios? ¿Estás contenta por los
sí,
cambios?
Sí, muy contenta.
Yes, yes, very, very happy.
Vaya, fue una alegría bastante grande que nos dieron.
So, should the changes go slow or should the changes go fast?
So, los cambios deberían apurarse o deberían aplacarse un poco? Oh,
bueno, que venga todo como tiene que venga todo como tiene que venir.
Everything has to come how it comes and how it should come.
Que relacione todo y que todo venga como tiene que venir.
The relationships and the people have to come when it comes.
That sounds like a life lesson.
Parece una lección de vida. Yes, it is.
Nos dieron más vida.
The line forms here because the fish and chicken has come when it comes, Thursday. It's kind of a social event and a real show of patience. The food comes from the Cuban government, and the people each have a little book with pages that show how much they get and when they get it.
They're getting their free portion of chicken and fish, and they don't get it again for another month.
So you will make it last the whole month?
No vaya a echarse pata.
¿Tú lo haces durar un mes completo?
No, hombre, no.
No?
No, wait for that, I run out.
Uno lo hace un día.
One day.
So the chicken and
for two people and we make it and that's it.
You get chicken and fish for 2 days, that's it?
And it's all done.
How long do you have to wait in line?
Como cuánto?
Como él tiene quien lo ayude acá, nos despachan pronto.
10 or 15 minutes quickly.
Él le ayuda y él le
do they ever run out before you get some?
No,
it's real restricted and it's meant for all of us.
Menos mal que no.
It's restricted, that's why they give us a little
ya
bit.
Venimos los seguros, sí.
Yeah, we come for sure because that's what we need for the month.
Gracias.
Estamos felices porque muchas personas cogemos ya.
We're just happy.
Cuando se acabó, pero no.
We're happy with what we get. Whenever there's none, there's none.
That's a good outlook, but it must be hard not to eat fish or chicken most of the month.
Pero es difícil no comer pollo y pescado todos los días en el mes.
Ah, bueno, no, porque después compramos otras cosas.
Oh, because then we go and buy some stuff at the black market.
No, después.
Her 15-minute prediction to get the food seems optimistic, and at first I could not figure out the banging sound inside the little shop. Turns out they have to pound on the fish and chicken to break it all apart because it is all frozen solid. They even weigh it frozen. But somewhere else in this neighborhood, somebody can do much better than frozen fish. We found the butcher by accident. It's not a place the typical American might be comfortable buying their meat. At the carniceria, they don't exactly hide the work or show off the product in a refrigerated case.
How much is chorizo?
¿Cuánto vale chorizo?
5 pesos.
5 pesos for five? How much?
¿Por cuánto? 5 pesos por cuánto?
For one.
For one?
For one.
That's high! What about these? What are these here?
Chuletas.
Like
it's
top?
It's for the grill.
Okay. Who comes and buys? People in the neighborhood?
¿Quién viene y compra? La gente del barrio. Everybody from the neighborhood.
¿Esto lo compré yo?
I bought that.
Yeah?
There's one for you back there.
Won't fit in my suitcase.
Que no le va a caber en la maleta para llevárselo.
No, se va a comer aquí.
There are a lot of smiles and a lot of laughter when Cubans let their guard down. But in many cases, the people are trying to put the best face on a bad situation. Romeo Medina finally got back in his bicycle taxi. But then there's a man like Efrain Sardinas. He walked up to us speaking English, claiming he wanted to talk politics. Efrain operates a taxi too, but only when the government allows.
We have to be on standby, we have to wait.
How long have you been on standby?
Hace cuánto?
Yo espero 3 meses.
3 months.
3 months? What are you doing for money?
It's difficult, man. It's very, very difficult. Not only for me, no. For these people, every people here in Cuba, they drive taxi, wait for your paper. You don't have paper, don't have money, don't have wife, don't have anything.
What you need, you think, is American tourists?
Lo que te hace falta aquí son más turistas?
Yes.
Make
for example, you can taxi.
For example, if you need a taxi.
You're a good salesman.
Yeah.
But you can't drive us today.
A few seconds after we thought the interview was over, we found out the real reason Efrain isn't working.
Did you tick off somebody in the government?
Yeah.
¿Alguien en el gobierno lo enojaste o no? Yeah, for talking much about politics.
Well, we didn't talk about politics here, so you're safe.
Aquí no hablamos de política, so vamos a estar seguros.
While he waits for permission, Efrain can still look forward to this life again on the narrow streets of Old Havana. It's clear that even though these people can't leave, they probably wouldn't go anywhere else anyway.
When you mix two centuries together and a 50-year-old embargo, you get many modes of transportation you might not have thought of before, all on the street, all at the same time, and occasionally you see the kind of traffic jam you never imagined in your life.
It's the 52 Dodge versus the horse and buggy, with a few guys pedaling their taxis thrown in to make this clash of the century's traffic tie-up even more interesting. And let's leave it to the street dog to announce the end of the show here. Oh, and make sure you thank that guy for the ride, kid. And while we're talking traffic, they're doing car repairs right on this very block.
What kind of car is it?
¿Qué tipo de carro es?
Lada.
Lada? Russian?
Ruso.
What year?
De qué año?
2000.
If you expected Havana streets to be filled with American relics of the decade that gave us rock and roll, you'd be about half right. First, a lot of them are very different under the hood. Since no replacement parts are being machined here, and 60 years is a really long time to rely on junkyard treasure hunting, a lot of the cars are not all mom and apple pie American under the hood. that 57 Chevy or Ford might be running around with a Nissan engine and a Toyota suspension. By the way, if it has a white license plate, the driver is connected to the Cuban government somehow. And for every one of these museum pieces, you'll see hundreds of these. The Soviet-created Lada, a boxy little tin can that never changed. They run forever, they're easy to fix. These guys are doing a little Dr. von Frankenstein to bring one back to life.
We cut it in between, in half, and we connected it with another car. The back is another car.
So you took the back half of a car, welding it to the front end?
Yeah. Since it was rusty and old, we took off of another car. That's the old one, right?
So this is what's left of the old car?
Eso es lo que queda del otro, ¿no? Just that.
That is shot.
Yeah.
Amazing. What can you sell that car for?
¿En cuánto puedes vender ese carro? 14,000.
But that may have been the friendly American tourist price. After all, to younger Cubans, an American must be the ultimate foreigner. But not to Moise Rodriguez.
I have many friends in Miami because I studied in the school, American school.
But when the 1959 revolution closed that school, most of Moise's classmates left. He figures the minute this interview is seen on American TV, his friends who left will recognize him.
But you stayed.
Pero te quedaste aquí.
Sí. Glad you stayed?
¿Estás contento que te quedaste aquí?
¿Qué voy a hacer?
Yeah. What am I going to do?
What Moise did do is track me down again a few minutes later, carrying his prized yearbook.
1960? It's even before me.
Right here, chest up.
You?
Yes.
Yeah?
Little did we know that by standing in that very same spot, we could get a valuable lesson in Cuban entrepreneurship. It came in a bag, on a rope, on a pulley, lowered from the roof. This is how you buy a phone card in Havana. To access the one and only mobile phone company in Cuba, Cubacell, owned by, you guessed it, the government. You don't see a lot of cell phones around here, and people text more than talk. But when that phone needs fixing or updating, this is where they go.
We unlock phones, we fix computers, and we fix every other electronics that we can get our hands on.
In the back, they salvage ancient computers that have never seen the internet and cobble together pieces of old, discarded cell phones. Their services include unlocking codes on phones from overseas so they will work in Cuba.
Do a lot of people have cell phones and computers, laptops here?
Since times are changing, yes. Now, they're exchanging a lot more. They're exchanging electronics a lot more. They're letting us buy and sell a lot more.
What about the service, the internet, the cell company? Do you have service?
The teléfono, el internet, el servicio de teléfono como tal, como.
No
internet.
We
unlock them with our laptops and with apps that we can find. And
just,
if we had internet, it'd be much easier. And if we do get internet, it's really slow.
How much money can you make?
It depends. It depends on the place. How many people are in town? Right now we're in the city with the major population. But it's the best business that we can be in.
They've been in the business about 18 months at this point. Most of the apps they sell come from mysterious sources, likely China. 20 to 30 apps, including games, Wikipedia, a translator, cost $5, which is a lot of money here. But the owners of Electrofusion are waiting for the wave of business they feel is coming. And so is a 24-year-old man in Havana's St. Joseph Market named Alex Cerbeto.
I'm just a salesperson. I work with tourists, selling artisanal souvenirs and stuff, everything in wood, you know.
Now, where did you learn English so well? You speak English better than I do.
Yeah, really? No, I learned English by watching movies and TV shows, so I never went to a school of English.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
So you know what's going on between Cuba and the U.S. right now?
Yeah, I know.
Yeah? How do you feel about it?
Oh, I feel very good because, you know, when you read, and then you go to the newspapers, you see the best tourists of the world are American. So I feel very well right now, because, you know, I feel great, you know, between the difference and stuff, I don't care, you know.
You don't care about the political differences?
I don't care about it. I just care about the people of the United States come here, enjoy my country, and then we can do some business, you know.
Would you like to go to the United States and visit?
Yeah, my whole family lives over there.
They
my
do?
My whole family lives in Las Vegas, Nevada.
No kidding.
Yeah, yeah.
So, your generation, you're 24.
Yep.
Is politics less important than the last generation as far as democracy versus communism?
What can I say? I just can't talk about me, you know? I can only speak about me. You know, all my friends like having money, you know? Politics, maybe when you're, is the hobby, you know? Mm-hmm. And then when they are, his politics is in all money, so they don't care about it. You know, communist or whatever, yeah, it's your feeling, I don't care, but I feel great that this stuff are happening right now, you know? Now, we don't care about politics, we don't care.
Some older Cubans praise Castro and President Obama in the same breath.
Viva Fidel, viva la revolución, el pueblo de Estados Unidos, ama todos unidos, venceremos.
They're still very reluctant to talk politics, though. They do admit a thaw in U.S.-Cuban relations doesn't just mean Americans coming to Havana to buy souvenirs.
Now, a lot of people here just want to talk about tourism. They just want to talk about getting more Americans here to spend money.
Exactly.
You have some political opinions too?
Oh yes, we Raquel and me, we are a big opinion about, for example, is the best, good idea for the Cuban people and the American people, and we have so a new relation, our two countries.
You hope the new relations between the countries?
Exactly. From the government and the people, and then, because in the future we can get a big opportunity.
Yes, you can get a big opportunity.
Exactly, for the Cuban people, everything, working, students.
Right.
Maybe we hope so. Someday, for example, in my opinion, someday going there, for example, 2 weeks maybe.
On a vacation.
Exactly, only for vacation.
Right.
I have my family here.
Claro, y no solamente que vengan a Cuba, que nosotros también podamos conocer.
We also want to know the rest of the world as well. We want to share cultures and ideas as well.
Do you feel like you and your family are missing out because you can't leave?
¿Te sientes como que estás extrañando algo porque no puedes, te estás perdiendo algo porque no puedes salir del país?
Claro.
Of course.
Conocimiento.
Of course, just reasoning.
La cultura.
The cultures, the differences.
You come to West Palm Beach?
¿Vas a venir a West Palm Beach?
Si tengo la posibilidad.
If I have the possibility.
No solamente eso, me gustaría conocer también, por ejemplo, Francia, Puerto Rico, me encantaría.
Not only the United States, but I mean, just Puerto Rico, Brazil, France, people that we do have relationships with, we can't even go and visit.
If that statement betrays any bitterness at all, it is still almost impossible to find anyone who would actually admit to it. Being careful that no one overhears you making a negative statement seems like second nature to Cubans. And it's not an arrest or imprisonment they fear. It's more insidious. Will someone make a call and hurt me economically? Dodging trouble is almost a reflex.
If you're expecting Havana to reflect a military state, you would be surprised. We've seen few police, fewer soldiers in our days on the streets here. The reason the woman in uniform is at this house, it's the birthplace of Cuban hero Jose Martí.
Martí is everywhere, part of the Cuban government's triumvirate of revolutionary patriotism. They're painted and plastered all over the city. The 19th century poet and writer who died in Cuba's war for independence from Spain, joined by Che Guevara, the Argentine Marxist who helped Castro overthrow Batista, and Fidel himself. And down the street from Artie's birthplace, there's even a school named for his father. And up on the second floor, the children are in class. But today's lesson isn't history, it's math and meeting an American TV crew.
Cuatro por cuatro.
There is a world beyond these streets that you'll never get to riding a bicycle. The road that takes you right by the Port of Havana passes by landmarks on the way to a Cuban life of privilege. In Vedado, there's the Hotel Nacional de Cuba, the showplace of the city. But don't expect to find room rates on the internet, don't expect five-star amenities, and don't expect us to stop. Since Cubans just work there, they don't really stay there. As we keep driving on the Avenue of the Americas, yes, really, the yards spread out, the homes expand into estates, and you realize the truth.
Inner city Havana really doesn't represent where all of the city of 2 million live. There are elegant parkways, manicured lawns, fine homes. It's just important to know that some of those homes were abandoned at the time of the revolution, and the government took them over and fixed them up. And you can bet even today, the best house on the block probably has some direct tie to the state.
For instance, this house, which would fit right in a lot of American neighborhoods, isn't just any home. When a woman came out while we were down the street to ask what we were doing here, the rest of our group quickly recognized her as a current star player on the Cuban national volleyball team. The arches and flagpoles here we're driving by mark the approaching U.S. Special Interest Building, the once and likely future home of the U.S. Embassy. Our driver tells us the flagpoles used to fly huge Cuban flags to block banners on the building filled with American propaganda. No banners, so no flags, and no telling how fast the future will come. But history is right up the road.
This is the memorial to Jose Marti, and I am standing in Revolutionary Square, where Fidel Castro spoke to the masses, where the Pope said Mass just a few years ago. But right now, no protesters, probably no Cubans. It's all tourists and no Americans besides us.
The office where Castro ruled from is somewhere here, and the Ministry of the Interior, run by Che after the revolution, now bears that unmistakable likeness. The words translate to, until the everlasting victory, always. But it's hard not to wonder if this is the victory people old enough to remember 1959 were really expecting. And as proud as the Cubans are of the revolution, that's not what they've immortalized and dramatized for tourists in Havana. Instead, there's still this nightly ritual that actually goes back centuries at the Fort of the Three Kings, Moro Castle. You want history, America? Construction of this fort was started about 30 years before the pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock. The Moro overlooks the harbor channel across from Old Havana and was erected to spot raiding pirate ships and stop them with cannon fire. But the cannons didn't end up being enough to stop the British Empire. Young Cuban men now in costume put the show on every night at the fortress. Moro fell to the British in the Battle of Havana in 1762. And even though Spain got the fort back a year later, the actors wear 18th century British uniforms during the long ceremonial firing of the cannon. It is the most elaborate display of military might, if you want to call it that, you're likely to see in Havana. And the show isn't even really about a battle. The cannon was fired at 9 o'clock every night to tell people to get inside the city walls because the gates were about to be closed. Oh, yeah.
todo aquí. ¡Azúcar!
Pam, para, pam.
¡Sí!
Pam, para, pam. Pam, para, pam.
¡Oye!
Pam, para, pam, para, pam. Pam, para, para, pam, pam. Pam, para, para, pam, pam.
Los Tres Hermanos play to almost empty cafes, collecting a few meager pesos a night. Walking these streets, it could be Barcelona, maybe even Rome, with the classic architecture, street-side dining, the dramatic lighting. But there just aren't that many people here. So many places are mostly empty, waiting for tourists. There's actually even a Chinatown here you can walk through, full of Chinese restaurants and more empty tables. We've discovered in the first 24 hours that people don't sleep in Habana Vieja. It's only the street dogs. But they're not all exactly out partying. A lot of them are more likely to be waiting for fresh bread in the state-run bakery at night. Sunday, there's no bread, so you need to get what you can for the weekend as soon as it's ready. And for the boys, a street light, a plank of wood, and dominoes take the place of an Xbox.
Who's the best domino player?
Watching them play, I wonder if they will be the generation who will see the change, if the barrier between Castro's Cuba and the U.S. really does fall away. No one can really predict how the change will come or when it will come, or even know if it will ever come.
Whatever change comes soon to Cuba will be pushed for mostly by the young people here. You're about to meet the man who may be the most popular young man in Cuba. He's been a star since he was 16. People refer to him as Cuba's Michael Jackson or Justin Timberlake.
His name is Osmani Garcia, also known as La Voz, The Voice. A star in Cuba since he was 16, he's now one of the country's most popular exports. But when I spoke with him away from the stage, he made sure to explain where he comes from and where he wants Cuba to go from here.
I also do know what it is to have no shoes and be raised with just a little bit of bread, barely enough to survive. And on behalf of all the people who have had to suffer the economical barrier between our two nations, we ask the American people to support us. We also have to dress and eat and raise our children. And it has nothing to do with the presidents of our nations, because they're just doing their job.
The Cuban government lets Garcia travel the world because he's willingly coming back to a country he genuinely loves. But most Cubans could never afford the $20 admission to get into this nightclub to see him. Reality is, most of the fans here are from Italy, Brazil, even China. And Garcia sees the road to a better life for his people running right through America.
It's a trail that I believe the Cubans should follow.
Do you see this as a seed to big change in Cuba?
It's the most important seed in my 33 years of life that I have seen between the two nations. 50 years of war has been too much. I believe it's time to change, and I believe it's time to negotiate.
Cubans in Havana ask, when will the change really come? Americans ask, is the time right to go to Cuba? Two questions that point to one answer. Cubans and Americans want to connect. And now that the door has opened, they will, no matter what our governments do or say. When I look back on this journey, the buildings, the landscape, the streets, colors, the music will all fade in my memory, but the faces of the people will not.
Nothing you can read or listen to or even watch can capture the warmth and generosity of the people we met here in Havana. Now, there is some fear they might get in trouble with the government, but once they know you're American, they will open up their hearts and their worlds to you. Diplomacy is going to have to wash away the decades of mistrust and fear between two governments, but that's politics. Once we looked into the smiling eyes of an elderly woman in old Havana, once we were offered that tall glass of rum in the airport when we landed that came from a Cuban music superstar, we knew this project would end up being about the people of Cuba, a people we never could have expected to feel so much love from. And we never could have anticipated the hope they feel now that they believe what they've wanted may finally be coming their way. I'm Todd McDermott. All of us who worked on this project hope you enjoyed this journey to Cuba Unlocked.